Okay, the recording has started. Okay, tek mi hocam?
Okay, so, well, I realized that in the last lecture, I sometimes wander off. Okay, so if you are giving a lecture without script, there is a little bit of, you know, random walk in it. And since there were good questions, I took my opportunity of random walk, but it wasn't completely random. It was a little bit directed by questions, but ultimately I went somehow a little bit advanced in some parts. So this time I will try to stick to a more or less, I will more or less try to stick to a script, okay? Now the lecture is quantum mechanics. I will still write things down, okay, as much as I can, because if you show slides, they go very fast, and I don't like it personally, okay? I like things to be written down and to be a bit slower at its own pace, and things like that, okay? So here is the thing. We will be interested in this kind of quantum mechanical system. I showed it here, where I wrote the potential in a particular way for a reason, okay? V of x potential is 1/2 w prime of x square. You know, w prime is some function, it doesn't matter. The reason I wrote it in this way is because in theories with fermions, it is more natural to write the instanton equation in terms of W prime. And also in theories with fermions, actually, when you couple, for example, this X of D coordinate to some Grassmann fields, this amounts to do the following in quantum mechanics. Actually, this is not something very fancy or complicated. X of t represents a particle with spin zero in quantum mechanics, okay? If you couple it to psi of t as well, so you can make it into, you know, let's say X of t is the word line of a particle with spin zero. But if you also couple it to psi of t in the way I have described, it is a particle on a word line X of t, but it has an internal spin 1/2, okay? So spin 1/2. But if you make two of these Grassmann fields, put an extra index there, x of t psi I of t. By the way, this case where your particle has internal spin 1/2 is called n equal 1 supersymmetric quantum mechanics, okay? It's a little bit small written, but actually you can actually couple more Grassmann fields to your X of T. This is also something, you know, from basic quantum mechanics, you know, instead of thinking this particle with this word line X of T with internal spin 1/2, you have to consider spin 1/2 times 1/2 times dot, 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 1/2. Just this thing goes nf times. So if you take nf equal 2, for example, it corresponds to 1 in the angular momentum 1 or spin 1 plus spin 0 particle with some particle with 4 internal states in quantum mechanics. Actually, you may or may not know this, but this class of theories for any, when you put this ordinary bosonic system to a number of Grassmann fields, they are super special. A large number, a number of ground states and low-lying states, actually NF low-lying states, if some mild condition is satisfied on W prime, are actually exactly solvable regardless of what your W is. This is quite remarkable. I am telling you that all of these things, all of these systems have exactly solvable ground states if you know, W actually the condition is W has to go to infinity. If you are doing particle on a line, particle on R, okay, if you are doing X of T on R, particle on a line, okay, then if W of X plus minus infinity goes to plus infinity in both ends in the same way, then you can actually show that a number of low-lying states are exactly solvable, and some higher states comes like that, and they are marginal. Okay, but first we will be interested with this simple little thing, purely bosonic quantum mechanics. Okay, so this is our goal. So really, physically, actually, this thing is also as interesting as that. You know, why not? And also, this thing provides, as I said, a prototype for NF equal one. It is supersymmetric quantum mechanics, and for larger NF, these are again carry over some interesting properties of supersymmetry, and this is very nice class of examples. Okay, so the distinction is following. So the wonderful thing about these systems is that the maybe let me first describe these purely bosonic parts, okay, which is described by these red dotted double well potentials or this nice periodic potential, okay, things like that. And then I will come back to the effects of these Grassmann fields in the game, okay? Is our goal clear? Okay. So I already made a very brief introduction to this double well potential, okay? This nice structure. So you can consider a particle on the left well or particle on the right well. And the potential can take this form. It is your choice. You can also write a potential which looks like x squared minus one squared, which is a minima. It's minus one plus one, which is more symmetric, but these are the same systems, just shifted. And here G appears in the Lagrangian, but you can also put G in front. In this case, in this normalization, you put G all up front, you know, x dot square plus x square minus one, the whole thing squared. It doesn't really matter, okay? Now, I told you some interesting things about this already. If you study perturbation theory on this left well or on the right well, it doesn't matter. If you can proceed to, you know, in a textbook or in our quantum mechanics class, I usually give my students as homeworks this order and this order, because this is what you can tackle with Rayleigh-Schrödinger perturbation theory. But I put a Mathematica package on the Slack page written by Tin Süleyman Pasić, and it's quite easy to go 500 orders in 2 hours. It's quite easy, 500 orders in 2 hours. And as I say, actually, it is not a numerical calculation, this thing. It's a symbolic calculation. So all of the results are analytical there, because you iteratively solve some iterative equation to derive the higher orders perturbation theory. For example, if we were not to consider, we were not to have computers, we wouldn't have a fundamental difficulty. With enough manpower, maybe 100 years ago, we could solve this thing up to maybe 30 order, 40 order. We could solve it in principle if we knew the Van der Waal method. So you can go 500 orders in 2 hours. If you want 100 orders, it is less than 1 minute. Okay, in that mathematical package. So you can see how your perturbation theory behaves in tremendous detail. And the fascinating thing is, to all orders in perturbation theory, this system has two ground states, okay? But non-perturbatively, if we have a particle, something like a particle here, x of t is on R on a real line, then this thing for such systems, the Schrödinger equation always has a unique solution. So quantum mechanical particle, you know, the ground state wave function is always unique. There is never a ground state degeneracy. In some interesting cases, there are cases with ground state degeneracy, but those are for deeper reasons, something related to something called anomaly, okay? But now, however, we can calculate non-perturbatively in this system some E0 and E1. Oh, this is E plus and E minus I called. E plus is symmetric ground state wave function. E minus is the wave function of the first excited state. It has one node, you know, node counting is a theorem. Okay, this has zero node, one node. Higher states have two nodes, three nodes, et cetera, et cetera. It goes so and so forth. And actually you can calculate this and the result is this, okay, in this convention. And if you also want to restore H bar, strictly speaking, the result is proportional to G square H bar. I again emphasize that if you take H bar goes to zero limit, there is no tunneling and the quantum mechanical system reduces to classical mechanics. And there are two distinct minima, vacua in that case, okay? Okay. Now, okay, so let me describe briefly tunneling. So the solution I wrote yesterday was actually correct, but it was for this x squared minus one potential for x squared minus one squared potential. If you look to x of tau, you have to look in these inverted potentials, okay, inverted potential here. And x of tau starts from here and ends up here, okay? But actually, I want to make one more remark. Here is the interesting thing. I said that yesterday, I said that if you look to a solution here, you can actually solve this system exactly, okay? And I realized that after talking about it, I realized that I could have said it better. And the better thing is following, actually. This is a classical mechanical system in one dimension. It is exactly integrable. Actually, if you solve this exactly, the exact solution, okay, carry information about this cycle. This is the real solution, okay? So if you, this is a genuinely real solution, but if you look to what that solution does, if you look to that solution more carefully, okay, x of t here, it is actually some Jacobi elliptic function. Elliptic function of one of those things, okay? Either maybe in periodic potential, it is Jacobi elliptic function, but this is probably, it has the same feature. And I will make a remark about it. Actually, obviously, if you are considering some energy level, this is a periodic function, right? If you look to classical paths, x of t, these are periodic paths. If you start a particle here and let it roll down, you know, from the rest, roll down, go up, come back, go up, come back. But if you actually look to the solution much more carefully, it is some Jacobi elliptic function kind of thing, but never mind the name. It is actually a doubly periodic function. But it is not only, if you look at more carefully, it is doubly periodic. And if you continue this function to the whole complex plane, it is periodic both in real direction as well as in imaginary direction. This is actually the origin of the elliptic functions. So in mathematics, the origin of the elliptic function is the simple pendulum. These are doubly periodic because if you continue time to Euclidean time, well, this system do get flipped, right? And this energy level here is mapped to somewhere here, okay? And there's another period. So if you are considering the solution, it's actually doubly periodic. But in classical mechanics, we are only interested with the real solution, okay? So these doubly periodic functions are very pretty, okay, very nice, and they are physically very interesting. And if you, in classical mechanics, actually, if you do not do simple pendulum in a hand wavy way, but slightly more precisely, you will end up with elliptic functions and you will end up with periods of the elliptic functions, 4k, 4k prime, and stuff like that. It doesn't matter. But the tunneling event is the event which extrapolates from this minimum to that minimum. And its weight, its magnitude is given by this. So the quantity it calculates is, let's say you started with the right well exponential minus beta h, it's a transition amplitude under Hamiltonian time evolution. And this is not equal to zero. And the thing that this is equal to is given by that up to some prefactor, okay? Now, how do we find this instanton solution? Okay, where is my equation? Okay, let me go here and then I will come back, okay? So write down this kinetic term plus W prime square, okay? So you see that this has a form which is very simple. It looks like A square plus B square. If you have something like A plus B square, you can always write it as A minus B perfect square and plus 2AB. And I wrote it exactly in this way here. There's a perfect square and there is this 2AB parts here. And this part is positive definite because it's a square of something. And it is saturated if this quantity here is strictly zero, okay? If it is zero, then it's saturated. And when it is zero, it obeys this condition, okay? This condition is actually implies d square x divided by d tau square plus del v over del x. So Euclidean equations of motions, okay? But if you take the configuration which satisfies this condition, you see there is an next term here plus x dot w prime and d tau. Okay, if you look at this thing, okay, so it is really dx over d tau, dw over dx, d tau. So everything here cancels. And this thing is actually integral over of dw from one critical point to another critical point. Critical point one, critical point two. So if you have, for example, you can just immediately calculate this if your W is, you know, something like X cubed divided by 3 minus X. So then W prime is X squared minus 1. So the critical points are plus minus 1. So the minimum of the potential is minus 1 and plus 1. So if, as you interpolate from minus 1 to 1, so this will be given by W plus 1 minus W minus 1. And this is in some magnitude. So plus 1, 1 third, it's like, okay, it is some number, something like 2/3 here in this case. It doesn't matter. But the only thing, so the thing that I want to show is this thing more carefully. So take one more derivative of this. Okay, so you can calculate the action in this way. It is easy. Take one more derivative of this. So X double dot is equal to, let's say, d over d tau w prime, but this is equal to w double prime, because this is equal to d w prime over dx one more time, and dx over d tau, okay? So this part is w double prime, and dx over d tau is again W prime. But I told you the potential was V of X was 1/2 W prime square. So if you take the derivative of the potential, it gives you just this. This is nothing but dV over dx. So X double dot is equal to dV over dx. And the nice thing about instanton equation is the fact that it is first order, it's a nonlinear equation. Let me make a remark. Nonlinear, okay. It's a nonlinear equation, but you can solve it. It is first order in quantum mechanics, you can solve it. And even in quantum field theory, in many circumstances, you can solve it exactly. And it goes from one minimum to another minimum, the solution. Okay, this is our instanton solution. Any questions about this at this stage? The only emphasis I want to give you here, I want to provide you here, is this word nonlinear. The fact that it is nonlinear tells you that if you superimpose two instanton solutions, it is not an exact solution. It is, you can view it as approximate, and we will gain a lot of mileage by understanding what that means precisely. Now, you find the instanton, but the question is not really to find an exact solution. What the dynamics does, what the dynamics of the quantum mechanics or quantum field theory does. There may be some solutions, some of them may be completely unimportant, some of them may be very important. And you want to understand what role they play. And in this example, we know they play a prominent role because they lead to tunneling. And probably one of the most important concepts about quantum mechanics is this tunneling, right? Now, however, okay, with my normalization here, with this potential, I see, with my normalization here, I obtain this this exponential of minus 1 over 6 g square. It is a non-perturbative thing. And I already made the important point that if you try to Taylor expand this in g, you know, try to write this thing down as, you know, let me call this function h, maybe h is not a good name, f, let's call it f. So it is f to the n, nth derivative evaluated at g equals 0 divided by n factorial g to the n. This would be the Taylor series expansion, but the point is this function here is has an essential singularity at g equals zero. This thing is called essential singularity. It is not a pole. It is much worse than or branch point. It is a much worse singularity. And if you try to Taylor expand it, you will obtain zero plus zero plus zero ad infinitum, okay? So this thing, this non-perturbative effect, and the thing that we calculated, perturbation theory, seems to be completely unrelated. This is one of the reasons that they are in different sections in a standard textbook in quantum mechanics, okay? But I already told you that this perturbation theory is an asymptotic divergence series. But Michael Berry says, you know, perturbation series is not a capricious thing. It doesn't diverge for no reason. It is trying to tell you. And if you actually read Arnold's classical mechanics book, you know, in one of the appendices, he makes these remarks about the behavior of the perturbation theory. And it says something like, you know, you are asking perturbation theory to do something that it can never achieve. Okay, I can even point you where the where it does that. Indeed, if you try to expand this thing in G, you can never achieve to construct such an exponential function which has an essential singularity at zero. And then Arnold says that, you know, the perturbation theory is actually diverging to tell you that there is something interesting going on. It is trying to inform you about that and, you know, pay attention. And even in actually in a number of classical mechanics problems, for example, I mentioned simple pendulum and I am supposed to, now I wrote these notes so that I will not divert from these notes, but I cannot resist make a remark about classical mechanics, okay? Because classical mechanics is a beautiful subject. If you take this classical mechanics of simple pendulum, for example, it doesn't matter. You know, simple pendulum, this is some angle theta going back and forth. If you look at the phase space, okay, so there is, of course, in the phase space PQ, there is these nice oscillatory things, okay, going back and forth. And if this thing can go all the way up and go all the way up there and return from there, this thing is called separatrix. Separatrix, because it separates one kind of motion from another kind, because from here on, it will actually be rotator-like motion from there on, okay? So you have this kind of phase diagram, okay? Even in classical mechanics, okay, if you do something interesting, if you, let's say in classical mechanics, we have Newton's equation, d square x, d t square is equal to minus del v over del x. And let's say, you made time discrete in steps epsilon, okay? And this is the, I think this is the discussion in the Arnold's book. It must be related to that discussion. It is understood more recently, but if you do this, something very interesting happens actually. This system, in some vicinity of this separatrix, becomes chaotic, okay? The reason is there is a finite step, epsilon, and well, when you, if you are away from this minimum of the potential, okay, if you are close here, it doesn't bother that you discretize time. But if you are close to here, once in a while, in this epsilon time step, you can stay inside or you can flip and start to do rotator-like motion. And this is effect is called separatrix splitting. And in classical mechanics for this effect, if you study, actually, you go ahead and study perturbation theory because of discretization. Take it continuous first, then introduce the epsilon as a perturbative parameter, okay, and study perturbation theory in it, you will discover that it is actually asymptotic again. And this effect is related to this thing called separatrix splitting. It's a very interesting effect. I wanted to think about it multiple times, but I didn't have time yet. And at some point I will come back, but let us not worry about this. Our concern is now quantum mechanics. Okay, we learned that perturbation theory is asymptotic. There are non-perturbative effects, which are called instanton effects. And actually here, I made a picture. So if you tunnel to one side, you can always tunnel back. Tunnel forward, tunnel back. Tunnel forward, tunnel back. And in a large time span, you can tunnel forward and back many, many times, okay? This thing is called, sometimes it is called instanton gas, because in the Euclidean time, if you think, you know, let's say you are in Euclidean time, R is tau Euclidean time. If you think like instanton course, like points, okay? Well, you have many of them, instanton, anti-instanton. You see that in a Euclidean context, this thing starts to look like a gas of classical particles. There are actually two ways to interpret this. One of them is like really like a gas of classical particles. And the other one is, despite its simplicity, you may think that this is just simple double well potential, but if you think about it, it is actually also intimately related to Ising model in 1D. For example, your particle spends most of its time at x equal minus one, sometime at x equal plus one, okay? Minus one, plus one. And once in a while, it does that. And, you know, it does something like that. But now, okay, this is, now let us discretize time. And call whatever the field at one end is by its value, that it is closer. So this is really nothing but like a spin down, spin down, spin down up to this point, then spin up, spin up, spin up, spin up, and then spin down, spin down, spin down. So there is actually an exact correspondence between classical Ising model in one dimension and a quantum mechanical system. That's also an interesting digression that may be interesting to know, but let us focus to what we want to do, okay? So we said perturbation theory is asymptotic, okay? So what do we do with it, okay? Actually, the gap is by this amount, and this is the heart of the matter, okay? If you did not pay any attention for some time, now look at it, okay? We said perturbation theory is asymptotic. And we also said that, you know, if it is asymptotic, I know what to do. I do Borel transform, then I do Laplace integral and try to calculate the sum, Borel sum. But if you work with this perturbation theory, okay, and do this Borel summation procedure, you learn that on the Borel plane, let me call this T Borel plane, you have a singularity here. And the funny thing is, this singularity is located at 2 times instanton action, the first singularity in the game. So indeed, you can do the Borel sum. So Borel sum. There is a, but then the Borel sum, the final result is actually ambiguous, twofold ambiguous. Oops. Borel sum is actually this. Let me call it plus minus, okay? Depending on your choice of this contour, Borel sum of perturbation theory, is there is a real part in this story, which is very nice and interesting. But the end result is there is plus minus I, there is some prefactor, exponential minus 1/3 g square, where this 2s instanton is 1/3 g square. So this is something very interesting. Now you did your perturbation theory, honestly, any order you want, okay? Then you calculated this Borel transform and Borel sum, okay? And you learned that.
This was the first singularity, right? There are others.
This is the first singularity.
Okay.
There are indeed others. And all of them are, in this case, in this particular case, on the positive real axis. You are right. Yeah. But let us focus to the first singularity because it is most important. So the main thing it is telling you is following actually. Yes, perturbation theory by itself was, you know, doing something weird. It looked almost meaningless because it was diverging for something, we know that there must be a finite answer. But this is the nature of the perturbation theory. Then we tried to fix that pathology, that disease, and we came up with this Borel procedure, okay? And we found that, well, we can make the result finite, but it is no longer real. It has an imaginary part. Then the imaginary part is twofold ambiguous. So we traded one disease with another disease. Both of them looks bad, okay? But this is actually we do not expect anything imaginary here because it's a stable quantum mechanical system. The Hilbert space is bounded below. Look, the system we are dealing with is double well potential, okay? There is no instability or anything like that. But actually, sometimes some news that we perceive as negative, in retrospect, maybe the best news that we have received, but we may not know that yet. And this is one of those stories, okay? The fact that this thing looks pathological is not actually a curse, okay? I will show you how this thing is fixed in a moment, and it is fixed in a very non-trivial way, but also reminiscent of our zero-dimensional ordinary integral case, okay? But here is the story, okay? So for perturbation theory, this is our final result. We are done, and we are at this stage in a bad shape. We are in a puzzle, okay? Now, here comes the thing, okay? So it doesn't, is equal to that. Let me go directly to where I want to go, okay? I want to say one more remark so that we will know that, okay. This is for harmonic oscillator, this is for, okay. Just give me a second. Okay. I am good. So if you are considering perturbation theory, I just want to make a few minor remarks. It is not only asymptotic and divergent for ground state. Here, n is level number, harmonic level number. And so n equals 0 is the ground state. and n equal 1 is first excited state, n equal 2 is the second, third, etc., etc. Okay. And this thing is actually, you can determine this perturbation theory as a function of not only coupling, but level number and coupling. Okay. Now at this stage, we did something interesting actually. We elevated this continuous parameter, the discrete parameter n to a continuous parameter, and we wrote a function which extrapolates between these discrete values correctly. And this result is actually in perturbation theory, it's exact. And if you work out large order behavior of the perturbation theory, actually you learn that perturbation theory is asymptotic for every level. And look, for n equals zero, capital N equals zero, it is gamma n plus one, it is just n factorial. But for n equal one, it is gamma n plus three, n plus two factorial, and so forth, okay? Now, actually the divergence is not only the leading n factorial part, there are other things in the game, and here are those things. There is an n factorial, but at sub-leading order, there is an n minus one factorial, because n factorial divided by n is n minus one. N factorial divided by n, n minus one is n minus two factorial. And there are all sorts of these subleading divergences, okay? Now, and yeah, this is the thing that you have to keep in mind. And as I said, you can determine some of these things precisely by using van der Waal package, for example. But now I will go to, it will look like I will do something different. Okay, this was the perturbative sector of the theory. And now I will do something with the instantons, okay? And here is the interesting story. I told you that if you take an instanton, it is like that, and it is an exact solution, let's say. But if you take an instanton and anti-instanton, this is not an exact solution. Not an exact solution. This is exact solution. And I want to characterize how it fails to be a not an exact solution. Maybe I should not use the word solution. Well, it turns out that I can use it. Let me use it for now, but for now it's a cheat. Cheat, okay. Let us characterize how it fails to be an exact solution, okay? So let's take a superposition. For example, in this, let me stick with this periodic potentials, okay? If you have an instanton, you can actually add to it another instanton or another instanton, it doesn't matter, okay? Or you can consider an instanton, you know, followed by an anti-instanton, I and I bar, coming back to the same point, okay? And for this system, let us write these things down. So for example, let us write the instanton solution plus another instanton solution separated from each other by a distance. This is located at tau one, and this is located at tau two. Okay, they are separated from each other by a distance tau two minus tau one. Okay, either like that, or as I sketched in the previous page, it is instanton and anti-instanton. This is centered at tau one, this is centered at tau two again, okay? Now what you can do is you can take the action and write in it x, I, tau, okay? And plug this action, plug this into the action. Your action is one half x dot square plus v of x, and you have to evaluate it at x of tau is equal to xii tau. And from there, if these things are very widely separated, you know, their action will be some of these two actions, but there will be some interaction left over between them. So the part of the action that depends on the separation, okay? So this is the two times the action part. And if you have instanton, it will look like there is an interaction which is repulsive, okay? If you have instanton, anti-instanton, there is an interaction which looks like it is attractive. But again, interpret these things in a Euclidean setup, you know, so this thing is favoring reduction of the action, and this thing, okay. So, but these words, repulsive and attractive, are just words, okay? So, and you have to make something more precise from there. And in the past, it caused a lot of confusion. For example, people thought that an instanton, anti-instanton, you know, can come and annihilate and et cetera, et cetera. Well, there is a configuration which is very close to perturbative vacuum and which looks like, for example, which looks like this, but this is in the, you know, like I and I bar, but this is in the perturbative fluctuations of the perturbative vacuum. This is really classical physics, this instanton description. There is a difference between not bouncing a ball on the ground and bouncing it and taking it back to your hands. In one case, you did not bounce it, you did not hit the ground. You know, you can jiggle it in your hand, the ball. Take a you know, ball and jiggle it in your hand. In the other case, you hit the ground and it comes back. There is a difference between these two. So an instanton is not, in quantum mechanics, is not a particle. It cannot really annihilate. If it happens, okay, if it happens, it cannot annihilate with an anti-instanton. And this is a statement that you see very often in literature. They say, oh, it is attractive, it can annihilate. And these are very imprecise statements. Never mind them. I will give you the precise description in a moment, okay? Now, the only thing that...
Yeah. Mithat Hocam, bir şey sorabilir miyim? Daha evvel dediniz ki bir instanton kesin çözüm ve non-linear dediniz. Peki iki instanton kesin çözüm değil. Peki linear olma olasılığı var mı?
Hayır.
O da non-linear.
Yani equation her zaman non-linear. Evet. Şeyi yazsam bile, second order equation of motion'ı yazsam bile, tau square is equal to del v over del x. Bu da, this is also a non-linear equation in this case, because evet, potential is quartic, so the right-hand side is cubic in principle. So it will not satisfy it, but the way it will not satisfy it, it will fail to satisfy it is by tiny amount. Because if these things are far apart, okay, you wouldn't care a bit. And this interaction is actually, if G is small, actually this thing, strictly speaking, will appear in the exponent. So the exponent will be exponential two times instanton action, and there will be this factor A over G, exponential minus tau 1 2, and the action here, you know, okay, I can describe this better. So S instanton was something like 1 over 6 g in our convention. I think maybe not, it is 6 g squared, but 2 S instanton is 1 over 3 g squared. If you take 1 over 3 g squared plus some constant divided by g square. I switched the convention of the coupling, I think, at some point. Sorry about that. Tau 1, 2. If tau 1, 2 is much larger than 1, this term is tau 1 2 is dimensionless here. Dimensionful, if you want me to write tau is genuine separation, there is a frequency here. Frequency times tau 1 2 is much larger than 1. Then this term is much, much smaller than that term. Even if you take tau 1 2 times omega to be 5, okay, it is or 10, okay, 10 units in the units of inverse frequency, okay, the instanton size is like omega inverse. So if this is 10 units apart, this term is like exponential minus 10, and this one is like order 1. Order 1 versus exponential minus 10. This interaction is fairly small, okay? It becomes more important as you make tau 1 2 smaller. If tau 1 2 omega is of order 1 2, then, well, there is an instanton, anti-instanton, but what is this exactly? So it's a little bit confusing issue, but I will make it very precise. Okay?
Teşekkürler hocam.
Rica ederim. Now, okay. Now I will make this problem much better defined. But before that, let me tell you what we do with these instantons. I said, you know, you have to now, this is probably one of the hardest parts, but at the same time, if you know statistical mechanics a little bit, and what something like grand canonical ensemble is, it is not difficult at all, okay? So now you have to think of an grand canonical ensemble of these things. So number can be anything. There is a Boltzmann weight for each one of these things. So actually these instantons are finite action, and this quantity that we are writing here, 1/6 g², this is actually density of instantons. Okay? And normally, if you ignore the interactions, let me make this dark. If you ignore the interactions between them, okay, you can take these instanton effects, and there can be arbitrarily large number of instantons, and you can sum them up. They will proliferate, as I said, and you can sum them up, and the sum will give you this kind of things, instanton amplitude to the power n, beta to n, so n factorial. And this thing is actually, you can derive this, maybe I derived it in my notes. So, for example, but you can sum these instanton effects and they come to the exponent like this, okay? You sum infinitely many instantons here, but in the energy, it appears as one instanton effect, okay? Summing over infinitely many type of instantons, it appears as a single instanton effect or single anti-instanton effect, okay? Never mind about these parts, okay? Okay. Now, one of the interesting thing is, this is actually, you can think of this as a robust statement, some sort of theorem, as good as a theorem can be in this context. Real saddle contributions, this will be very important to ground state energy. Are always negative. And so delta E due to instanton is actually less than zero. This is an important statement, okay? And the way to see this is not really difficult, because E zero here is just harmonic ground state energy, omega divided by two. And if you sum up the instantons, this thing exponentiate, it gives you exponential beta I but there is an overall, in the Boltzmann weight, there is an overall minus sign, and you take the whole thing into a parenthesis, so there is a vacuum energy and there is minus instanton and minus instanton bar, okay? So keep this in mind because it's an interesting statement. Real saddle contributions to ground state energy are always negative, okay? So, okay, any questions?
In the first example you have given like two lectures ago, there was imaginary saddles, right?
Right.
So what, this does not say anything about them, right? Do they increase the current energy or something like
actually,
that?
Actually, they will become very, they will become very, they can introduce contributions with either signs, okay? But I will give an example of that, okay, in which it is quite instrumental, quite important. And, but, you know, for example, the statement I am making was a source of confusion for many QCD theorists and supersymmetric theorists for many years. One of your friends, maybe it was you or somebody else, pointed out that, you know, in perturbation theory, ground state energy in supersymmetric systems is always zero. And in supersymmetric systems, we know that energy of the levels are positive definites, okay? But in supersymmetric systems, certainly there are non-perturbative effects, right? There are instantons. It is benchmark like every other system, there are. Yet, the ground state energy is supposed to be positive definite. But for a QCD person, instanton contribution was always negative. It always reduced the ground state energy. You see the clash? There is a very severe difficulty here. On one hand, people do this nice naive calculation and they get something negative. And on the other hand, this thing, there is a theorem by supersymmetry which tells you that non-perturbative contribution are positive semi-definite. I will come back to this question, okay? So it's an interesting question, and what complex configuration does is also a very interesting question. I will come back to that. But for now, I am describing relatively simple situations like double well potential or bosonic potential. Is that clear?
Yeah, okay.
Okay. So
Mithat hocam, bir de geçmeden bu yazdığınız teoremin adı nedir acaba?
Bu teori var mı bilmiyorum. Ama teorem statüsünde olduğunu şuradan biliyoruz. Çünkü PET integrali well defined, even if we assume that PET integral is not well defined, you can deduce the same result, you know, from WKB, but there is a precise dictionary between WKB and PET integral method, and this is the instanton contribution, and from there as well that we know that the contribution to ground state energy is actually negative. Okay, so when you have level splitting, one level goes down and the other level goes up.
Teşekkür
ederim. The thing is, this was something fairly standard reviews on instantons. Sometimes it is emphasized, sometimes it's not. It is sort of in the middle. But for real saddles, this is a robust statement, I think, as it stands. Okay. Now, so this thing, the separation is the thing. For example, in the double G. In the double well, it is the thing that leads to this separation of these two degenerate levels. They split up and E0 goes down. It is H bar omega divided by 2 minus exponential S instanton, and E1 goes up omega over 2 plus exponential minus S instanton. And sometimes people try to rationalize you know, some experts at some point I spoke, you know, tell me that, oh, if instanton does not lead to, you know, they try to rationalize based on energetics. And they say that if it doesn't lead lowering of the ground state energy, why should it happen? You know, there is no, but this logic is completely incorrect, as we will come to, as we will see. Now I want to make this problem a little bit better defined. Okay, so this is our story. Plus, actually, I wrote down the interaction between an instanton and instanton on R. Okay, or I and I bar again on R. Okay. But when we are considering partition function, we are considering trace of exponential minus beta h, okay? So that means that the Euclidean time is a circle. So if I take an instanton here and instanton there, or instanton here, anti-instanton there. There is a separation between them called this tau, but they are also interacting with each other from the other side. Let me call this distance beta minus tau. Here, there is tau, there is beta minus tau, okay? Now, I just want to remind you something. In statistical mechanics, I will tell you a fancy word, but the underlying physics is very simple. It's like freshman physics, okay? So it's not freshman, but undergraduate physics. So there is something called cluster expansion, okay? When you have things interacting with each other, for example, if you take, now if things are interacting with each other, okay, then in this thing, there are also interaction between instantons or between in statistical physics, there are pairwise interactions between classical particles or triple interactions like V1-2, V1-2-3, and so on and so forth, okay? If you take the effect of these interactions, there is a piece which looks like, for example, if you have two body here, okay? You can, and if you are looking to, you know, to its effect at some distance from them, say here, like Coulomb field, for example, if you are looking at it from here, there's a charge here, plus Q, then they add up, but you know, you can see the effect of Q much more pronounced wave when it is closed here, close to here, single charge. But if you are looking to the field here, these two things looks like charge two configuration, you know, like plus two Q configuration. Or if you have plus Q and minus Q, when you are close, you can see the effect of the charge here, for example, in the Coulomb field. But if you are far away here, the effect that you will see is a dipole effect. So, you know, and in this cluster expansion, when you integrate out, for example, here, there is the position of the first particle and position of the second particle, and there is tau one and tau two, okay? Normally, if there was no interaction, okay, tau one minus tau two, define a tau relative and and tau center, okay? And you can define a tau center, tau relative, and if you integrate it, if you integrate over these coordinates, you know, this will generate for you a two instanton effect, C square, a two particle effect, okay? But assume there is an interaction between them. And this thing will be extensive with the volume of the space multiplying beta square. But now assume there's an interaction between them. This tau center you can still do, but there is a d tau exponential minus v tau, and tau center you can do that integral. You got something, okay? But if you do this integral will in general turn out to be independent of beta. It will not be extensive in beta. So the next term here will still be C square, but it will not be extensive in beta. It will be sub-extensive in the language of Studmach. So the implication of this is following. If you are taking this thing as a two independent configuration, you also have to think as if it is a single configuration, okay, with whatever its effect is, but there is also a, you know, when you do this integral, there is also a prefactor in front of it, whatever it is, integral here, very important. And the effect of this single configuration is this, like C squared times I, okay? So this thing is called cluster expansion. So for example, here, there is contribution of one particles in the language of statistical mechanics. There is also contribution of two clusters. Here in the tree case, there is contribution of three independent particles and two clusters and one separated and a contribution of a three cluster. As if there is a single object here contributing as a single entity there. So if you really calculate this kind of integral in statistical mechanics, you will get a summation. You will get a functional form which will look like beta cube C square, but then there will be some beta square with some integral one, let me call it, and beta integral two. But you know, if you were to interpret this, you would say that, oh, this is just coming from proliferation of individual three particles. But you would say for this, what you would say for this is that this is coming from a correlated tree object. It is like a molecule. And if you know, for example, coarse graining in a renormalization group or statistical field theory, this is actually roughly what it does. So you can have many, many charges here, okay, here and there, but you know, one color, another color. But if you do coarse graining, for example, it's some length scale like this. This thing will look like a dipole. This thing will look like charge two plus two. This thing will look like charge minus two. Okay. So in fact, this instanton expansion, I first did not bother about these interaction terms and I just calculated. And it gave me this leading correction, instanton and instanton. But there are also contributions that you have to identify as correlated instanton, correlated to instanton. This is really two cluster. Correlated to anti-instanton, this is also a two cluster. And correlated instanton anti-instanton pairs, which looks like a dipole, okay, from a certain perspective. Is this clear? This may be technically a little bit difficult, but intuitively it must make sense. In some sense, in electrodynamics, if you remember, when we were studying electrodynamics with some charge distribution, right? If you have some charge matter here, you know, then if we look to its effect at large distances, there is a monopole term, there is a dipole term, there is quadrupole term, pole term. But these things are actually different clusters, right? Monopoles are single charges. Dipoles are two charges. Quadrupoles are four charges. And when we try to classify the field at large distances, this is how we describe it. Okay. Now we will do the similar procedure for instanton. Okay. But now I told you that the interaction has, if I compactify the space to a circle, interaction has two sides. And this interaction will be A over G, for example, exponential minus tau. And from the other side, there will be another term, again, A over G, exponential minus beta minus tau. The interactions will be like this, okay? And from two sides, okay? Here is what I wrote down. Now, story becomes a little bit more interesting. I told you that an instanton, anti-instanton configuration on R was not an exact solution. It was not a critical point of the action functional, okay? But if you look at this quantity here, let's say repulsive potential, okay, plus. Sketch this. One of them, tau is restricted to be zero to beta. One of them is like exponential minus tau, the other is exponential minus beta minus tau. This function looks like this for plus. And for minus, you know, the overall sign minus, well, it looks like this. And you see something interesting. So, at beta over 2, look at here, beta over 2, let's say you have instanton, instanton. If it is repulsive, okay, this is a stable critical point. If you move this a little bit to this side, this one will push more from this side, and this is a stable critical point. This is this picture. Okay. And if you do instanton anti-instanton, I and I bar, this is a maximum of the action configuration. If you jitter this a little bit, it will look like it will fall off. It is an unstable critical point. But like, as I said, in the case of, you know, for example, electric charges and dipoles, you know, in classical electrodynamics, if you have a positive and negative charge, they will not annihilate each other, okay? They are charges. In classical electrodynamics, you can even view them, yes, they can attract, but they will not annihilate, okay? So, but if you look to these pictures, this tells you that this case is a stable critical point, and this case is an unstable critical point. So, normally, depending on the separation now, when we define the theory on the circle, and if we are considering thermal partition function exponential minus beta h, this is what we are supposed to do, okay? Instanton-instanton, as well as things like instanton-anti-instanton can become genuine critical points. But the question is, where is the critical point? Where is it located at? The answer is at beta over 2. So if you take the limit beta goes to infinity, this critical point moves off to infinity. And this concept is sometimes called, this is important, let me write this down, is called critical point at infinity. I will get a cup of water. In the meantime, if you have question, please prepare. Any questions? Okay. Now, okay. Now, we can actually do these integrals, okay, depending on the separation to find the contribution of this II bar or instanton-instanton or instanton-anti-instanton contribution. Now, however, we also learned something interesting. If this is a stable critical point, okay, let me sketch one more thing. If it's a stable critical point at beta over two, okay, in the tau direction, we saw that potential looked like this. So the steepest descent cycle is in this direction. Descent. For the other way around, when it is unstable critical point, okay, again put beta over two, steepest descent direction is actually this direction. The other direction becomes steepest ascent, because if I really move this thing a little bit on the real direction like that, it will collapse. Okay, so steepest descent is this other direction. You can, for G square is equal to magnitude G square exponential plus minus I zero. You, by making the argument of G square slightly positive or slightly negative, you can actually determine this steepest descent cycle. It goes like this. Either that, this is one cycle, or this. Either that or this, okay? You can do this integral exactly, okay? By the way, you can do this integral exactly also in this case where steepest descent direction is this. There is no difficulty, you can do it and you find a correlated instanton instanton contribution, II contribution. So it gives you something like this. There is this exponential minus 1 over 3g, but this integral gives you something like log 1 over g or something like that. But if you do this second integral, and it doesn't matter if you do it for G square, if you do it for argument of G square positive or negative, it doesn't matter. This is the final result here. It is not square of an instanton. Okay. There is this log one over G part, and it is related to its intrinsic nature that it is really different from a separated instanton anti-instanton event. Separated instanton anti-instanton event contributes at some more relevant order. This will contribute at second order in semiclassics, okay? Now, here is the surprise. If you do this second calculation, you will get, depending whether you use this C1 or C2, you will get log minus one over G square, exponential minus one over 3G square. And this thing is log 1 over g square exponential minus 1 over 3g square plus minus I pi exponential minus 1 over 3g square. Now we are in a very interesting situation. We calculated second order effect in semiclassics, which is coming from instanton, anti-instanton, now correlated pairs. We found the critical point, okay? And we did an integration over the steepest descent cycle. But it turns out that depending on how I approach this physical G is positive and real. But exactly at that point, the integral is ambiguous, actually. You can make its argument slightly positive or slightly negative. And you see that the way it approaches in the G-square plane, okay, you can make this G-square slightly positive or slightly negative. But the final result of the integration depends on the way you approach the physical axis. And the result is twofold ambiguous. Now, I told you that some news which looked like bad news may actually, in retrospect, become good news. But now look at the form of this ambiguity. This thing, okay? And remember the form of ambiguity that we obtained in perturbation theory. Where did I write it down? Okay, this was coming completely from perturbative data. Okay, and in my last analysis, we did an analysis over a non-perturbative sector, and this comes from this comes from the non-perturbative sector, instanton, anti-instanton. Here is the fascinating thing, okay? We calculated this, okay? So there's a real part which looks like, you know, which gives some contribution, modifies I bar, you know, enhances it in some way. And this is leading order, honestly. I can go ahead and do perturbation theory around these configurations. This is not easy. One cannot do this at the, you know, it is not accessible immediately. It's not very easy, but one can do it. And for the greater, for the statement of the greater truth, it is important. Hence, we will tell you, I will tell you what it is. You do perturbation theory around this configuration and you obtain these 1 plus 5 over 2, 13 divided 8, blah, blah, perturbation theory. This is really perturbation theory around the non-perturbative sector in the story, okay? But now actually, I want to remind you, the large orders of the perturbation theory around the perturbative saddles. N equals zero, okay? There was an N factorial divided by 2S instanton, N plus one factorial. And there are these subleading terms. Look at the coefficient of the subleading terms, okay? So this thing literally mimicking whatever we obtained in the case of ordinary integral. But now we are actually dealing with an infinite dimensional integral, okay? So we calculated this quantity, imaginary part of instanton, anti-instanton, it was twofold ambiguous and pathological by itself. We also calculated Borel resummation of the perturbation theory. And yet and behold, the combination of these two things is actually canceling. And this is an imprint of something called resurgent cancellation, okay? Resurgent cancellation. This part of the story, just this part of the story, okay? And this thing, this part, was obtained by actually interesting Bogomolny and Zinjustan. Both of them are outstanding theoretical physicists I put them here. But the problem was following. You can say that this looks like a fascinating story, and you know, it looks very convincing that, you know, the semi-classical analysis can be made exact. There is some underlying deeper structure here. But the problem was following. These folks actually did this leading part in early 80s. Only just leading terms here, okay, in the early 80s. The problem was nobody cared. And nobody cared for some reasonable reasons, okay? The reasonable reasons was that their way of calculation was actually super vague. Nobody actually, I do not think that people actually completely believed their results. And if you, I never like to talk about citation history, but the for these people, when I understood, I was fascinated by their results personally. Okay, I think when I first saw this, I thought it was a very deep result, and there must be some even deeper reason underlying the whole story. It cannot be an accident. But I tried to reproduce their calculation the way they did, and you know, it is like sweeping the dirt under the rug. Okay. There are some quite non-rigorous steps, and somehow I think intuitively they knew the answer. This is a sign of being great physicists, and indeed both of them are, okay? But the problem was that nobody believed. And I think the time I referred to their work, one of them had maybe 15 citations, the other had 20 citations over the span of 30 years, and now both of them has 200 citations after my work and with Gerald Dunn, because we found a rigorous way to understand these things by using these multiple methods. We actually developed this steepest descent idea, this Lefschetz symbol idea, relatively afterwards. And then we also did something else different from them. We actually calculated these sub-leading terms, and we showed that actually the cancellation was not only at leading order and was something that's taking place as you proceed this whole story. But the fact that it proceeds, it continues to hold, tells you that this is a robust structure. And I want to tell you something about this. You know, why this is like a little bit of a story, but I think it's an interesting story. I don't want to say inspirational because I don't see myself as inspirational, but the interesting thing is following. We do perturbation theory, the whole community does perturbation theory, we do semi-classics. And this thing tells you that each one of these things individually are void of meaning. They do not have any meaning, they are not well-defined. And if you take our standard approach, on the other hand, we have this thing called hat integral or partition function, or we understand, you know, if we want to believe that the combination of our methods, perturbation theory, semi-classics, et cetera, et cetera, if we want to believe that that is something meaningful, there is not much of an option. You know, even without starting this calculation, you know, one is forced to think that either such a cancellation is true, or many brilliant people are talking nonsense for 20, 30 years. And I wanted to believe that this cancellation must be true. Okay, so, and then, you know, with some years of work with some friends, primarily with Gerald Dunn, we showed this structure, and we also showed that there is this fascinating underlying mathematical structure called resurgence theory. And resurgence, the word means something like resurge, surge up, born again. And you see that actually in this story, everything comes to life in another form again and again and again. You know, here you do have some perturbation theory around instanton, anti-instanton configurations. Its action is controlled by 2SI, and its perturbative fluctuation are by these red numbers that I dictated here. And you go ahead to large orders of perturbation theory, the same numbers play a role, the same perturbative expansion coefficients comes again to life, hence the name resurgence. And the name is coined by this French mathematician, Eccles. Who established the fundamental formalism for this. But even that was, and this is again done between probably for mathematics literature, it's fairly recent, between maybe 78 to 80s. And actually I suspect Eccles and Zinjustin are in very similar places. But the problem there was the following. I can also tell you this story. In year 2012, in North America, I have given a talk at Simon Center, and nobody knew the name of neither Eccles nor the word resurgence. But now, so it was something really like underground mathematics, if you wish, you know. He's a very interesting man, very strong character, but he does things of his own and he cares about them very deeply, about the things that he do. But I do not know if he cares about communication, And some of the things he did became remained very obscure for a very long time. But then there were some simultaneous progress by Chris Hulls from Southampton University and Michael Berry from Bristol. And they also understood that some things they were doing were related to this. But then, around 2010-12, with this friend of mine, Gerald, we came up with this more complete story in quantum mechanics. And after that, everybody started to accept that this is actually a rigorous story. And then, of course, another booster was that, around the same year, independent from us, I am pretty sure of that, but one of the most important mathematicians, Maxim Kontsevich, started work on this idea of resurgence and Lefschetz symbols. And so that also helped the field quite a bit. But since 2012, the scene changed quite a bit. And we had maybe, this sounds like self-advertisement, but it's really advertisement of the field. If it sounds like self-advertisement, I have apologies for it. But there had been like 15 conferences at very good places like Santa Barbara, Simon Center, and Cambridge right now going on, Japan IPMU, everywhere that accommodates such kind of important conferences. Or I did actually the first conference on this field, and I was invited from the theory group by at CERN, and I was personally quite proud of it, honestly. So there was a string theorist and who came up with similar ideas with us and Gerald. And the first thing happened at CERN in 2014. But now, one reason I am telling you this is actually this, not because of its technical achievement, because of its the mental step in it. It makes you think that semi-classics can actually be exact if you do it sufficiently rigorously. And on the path integral, if you know all of your saddles, you can make your story fairly close to exact. Or maybe even exact, I do not know. It is still something in progress. The other part of the story is that if one has, for example, extremely well-motivated youngsters, you know, young people have a lot of time and they are very powerful in general. And they can actually do some of these things and try to understand these kind of structures in diverse set of problems. And actually here, I was at NC State and I am still there. And here, some people who are doing hydrodynamics started asking me some questions about this, how it works, this iterative structure. And they ended up writing some of the very interesting papers in hydro, things related to Navier-Stokes equation and stuff, also hydrodynamic equations of states and by using resurgence techniques. And it seems to be very powerful. But I can actually stop now because this other subject, maybe supersymmetry and the other systems, I can start tomorrow and describe them tomorrow. And if you have questions, I think it's a very good point to stop. If you have questions, I can take the questions for this part of the story. And of course, the fundamental reason I am telling you this story is because this is something at the fundamental level in quantum mechanics. This progress that's happening around the WKB path integral is sort of, created another renewal of interest in some fundamental computational aspects of quantum mechanics recently. And these are things that are not far away from, level of understanding of an extremely good undergraduate or a good graduate student. So, please ask me your questions if you have any.
Mitajan, thank you so much. It was nice to talk again.
Sure.
And let's take a few questions before we start recording, if we have any. Okay, the audience seem to be satisfied. Okay, let me then stop the recording, then we can go on informally.
Yeah.